أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على خير خلقه العبد المؤيد والرسول المسدد حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته المنتجبين. قال الله تعالى في كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ومن الناس من يشتري لهو الحديث ليضل عن سبيل الله بغير علم ويتخذها هزوا أولئك لهم عذاب مهين. صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. The following verse revealed in Surah Luqman, verse number 6, has two occasions of revelation. Two reasons have been given why this verse was revealed. One occasion is that there was a man during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi by the name of Al-Nadr ibn al-Harith. He was a merchant and he would travel to many places. But one area that he would concentrate on was the Persian Empire. He would go and trade, buy, sell, and bring merchandise back to the Arabian Peninsula. When he would come back, he would come back to Mecca and sit with Quraysh. He would tell them, I have good stories for you. I have better stories for you. While Muhammad tells you, صلى على محمد وآل محمد. This is a salawat for those who have been fasting for 20 hours or so. But I'd like a better salawat, please. صلى على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صلى على محمد وآل محمد. We're approaching iftar, so you should be more excited than this. He would tell them that Muhammad tells you the stories of Ad and Thamud and others, but I have better stories for you. I have come to you with the stories of Rustum and Isfandiyar and the stories of Kisra. And some would abandon Rasulullah while he would state to them the Qur'an and the stories of the Qur'an, and they would come to this man as they hear the stories of legendary stories of the Persian Empire instead of listening to the Quran. So Allah revealed this verse. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْتَرِي لَهْوَ الْحَدِيثِ لِيُضِلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. And some people buy vain talk to be distracted from Allah and to be misguided. This is one occasion. Another occasion that we'd like to concentrate on is that during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi, a man bought a female slave who had a specific specialty. Her specialty was singing. She was a singer. She could sing. She had a beautiful voice. This man bought this female slave so that she may sing for him all day and distract him from Allah. When he did so, Allah revealed this verse. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْتَرِي لَهْوَ الْحَدِيثِ. لَهْوَ الْحَدِيثِ here means those who buy singing, those who buy songs, which could also entail those who buy music and singing to what? To be distracted from Allah. لِيُضِلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. Thus, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here calls singing and songs and music is also in the same category, calls it what? Vain talk. لَهُوَ الْحَدِيثِ. In a hadith by Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, he says, الْغِنَاء مَجْلِسٌ لَا يَنْظُرُ اللَّهُ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ وَهُوَ مِمَّا قَالَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْتَرِي لَهُوَ الْحَدِيثِ لِيُضِلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam tells us what Allah means in this verse by لَهُوَ الْحَدِيثِ, vain talk. Vain talk is singing. What do singers sing about? Is it something philosophical? Is it something spiritual? Is it religious? It's all vain. It's all nonsense. It's all ridiculous. It harms and doesn't benefit. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. There are many youth in the West that, alhamdulillah, are very religious. I can say that many youth in the West are a lot more religious and law-abiding than many youth in the East, in our home countries in the Middle East. Many youth in the West are a lot more religious. They pray, they fast these long hours, especially here in Europe, when fasting can last up to 19, 20, 21 hours in some countries. They pray, they fast, they observe hijab. They follow the laws of Allah and the laws of the Qur'an, and they abide by the laws of and teachings of AhlulBayt. However, some youth have a weak point, and that weak point is music. A lot of religious youth that even come to the Islamic centers and perform all of the religious rituals, but their weak point is music. They can't stop listening to music. Whether it's in the car as they drive to work or school, or at work, or in the gym when they're working out, or at home, they're listening to music. Or if they hear someone else is listening to music, they don't care. They take it very lightly. If their brother or sister is listening to music on TV, they don't tell them to lower the volume, or their children, so on and so forth. They either listen to music themselves, or they take the concept, the topic of music very lightly. And this is unfortunately very disappointing. But some might ask, well, Sayyidina, why is music haram? First of all, is music haram or not? Second, why is it haram? What's so wrong about music? Music puts me at ease. It makes me comfortable. It makes me relaxed. It puts me in a better mood. When I listen to music, I feel comfortable. It changes my mood. Why is it haram? It's supposed to be good. In fact, some might even say that music is something natural. It goes with our nature. Yesterday, I was reading some research online about music, and I saw someone had stated that even newborn children, when they listen to music, they start moving. As if saying, even children, newborn children dance. Or some researchers say that fetuses in their mother's womb, if they hear music, they begin to move. They say, see, this is natural. Otherwise, why would a child start dancing? Why would a fetus, even before being born, start moving? Doesn't this mean that singing and music and dancing is all natural? This is ridiculous. We shall examine this in further detail. Thus, some say, why should music be banned? Why should music be haram? Everywhere we go, there's music. On TV, at the mall, even in an elevator when you're going from the first floor to a second floor, there's music. Wherever you go, there's music. Even on the news, even at church, there's music. Doesn't this mean that music is part of human nature and that it's something very, very natural, just like breathing, just like eating and drinking? This is what we shall address tonight, inshallah. Wa sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Before anything, let's see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to say about music. Is music addressed in the Quran? Yes, it is. Explicitly, not explicitly, but various verses have addressed Quran, and with the help of the explanation of the Ahlul Bayt, this is very important. Some people, they come to me and they say, here, Sayyid, this is the Quran. Tell me, where does it say that music is haram? Where does it say? I say, we have the Quran, and at the same time, we need the help of whom? The Ahlul Bayt, to come and tell us this verse means so and so. Yes, we have several verses. One verse is the one that I just recited in Surah Luqman, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْتَرِي لَهْوَ hadith. In another verse, in Surah Al-Mu'minun, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. And then it gets to this verse, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. Believers are those that avoid لغو. What does لغو mean? لغو means also vain talk. Vain talk. Have you seen some parents when they tell their children, لَتِلْغِي, don't say stupid things, don't say vain talk, useless words, meaningless words. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرُضُونَ. According to AhlulBayt, they say that al-lagh here means singing and music. And another verse, فَاجْتَنِبُوا الرَّجْسَ مِنَ الْأَوْثَانِ وَاجْتَنِبُوا قَوْلَ الزُّورِ. Allah commands us to avoid false words. وَاجْتَنِبُوا قَوْلَ الزُّورِ. قَوْلَ الزُّورِ is false words. According to hadith, that false words here means singing and music. Yes, indeed. Singing and music is false words. What do they have to sing about? You've heard singers, the popular ones, the not so popular ones, whether it's in Arabic or in English or Urdu or Farsi or any other language, what is it that they're singing about? Is it something useful? Is it something meaningful? Is it something that benefits you in your life? Something that you can benefit with? No, it's all useless. And another verse, وَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِاللَّغْوِ مَرُّوا كِرَامًا. Those, وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَانِ. وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَانِ, the servants of Allah. وَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِاللَّغْوِ مَرُّوا كِرَامًا. When they pass by لغو, they pass by quickly. They pass by quickly, they don't listen to لغو. What does لغو mean? Again, vain talk. According to the Ahlul Bayt, vain talk here means music and singing. When we come to the hadith of Ahlul Bayt, we see that Ahlul Bayt, they took a strong position against singing and music. In a hadith by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi, كَانَ إِبْلِيسَ أَوَّلُ مَنْ تَغَنَّى. أَوَّلُ مَنْ تَغَنَّى, it was shaitan, the first to sing. Subhanallah, when we look at shaitan, we see that he was the first to do many things. The first to feel arrogant. The first to feel jealousy and envy. And the first to sing. If shaitan is the first to sing, that tells you a lot about singing. That tells you a lot about music. If shaitan is the first to sing. And a hadith by Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, بيت الغناء لا تؤمن فيه الفجيعة. A house that has music, a house that plays music all day and all night, a house that doesn't lower the volume of music, لا تؤمن فيه الفجيعة. Sudden disasters occur in that house. When all of a sudden you see a disaster occurring in your house, first go and ask, what happened? What is the reason? One of the reasons is music. When music is played in a house. وَلَا تُجَابُ فِيهِ الدَّعْوَ. And our prayers and dua will not be answered. Some people say, why isn't my dua ever answered? I have someone who's ill, someone who has cancer, for example, and I continuously pray for them, but Allah does not answer my dua. Why? This is one of the reasons. Because we have music in our houses. وَلَا يَدْخُلُ فِيهِ مَلَكٌ. Or al-malak, angels will not come into our house when there's music being played. That means if angels do not come, then who comes instead? It's either angels or whom? Shayateen. Shayateen will come instead. And another hadith by Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, al-ghina yurithu an-nifaq wa yu'aqibu al-faqr. First of all, music and singing brings hypocrisy into a person's heart. A person becomes hypocritical. يُنْبِتُ الْنِفَاقَ فِي الْقَلْبِ means that hypocrisy will come and sit in that person's heart. Not that a person will become hypocritical and become a hypocrite for a day or 2 days. No, hypocrisy will come and sit in that person's heart. That person will become a hypocrite. He listens to music, but then at the same time, he wants to come and pray. He wants to go and do the ziyarah of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. This person listens to music and at the same time he wants to read Qur'an. and listen to dua Abu Hamza Thimali. How? How? How is this heart that is hypocritical, that listens to music but at the same time wants to listen to dua Abu Hamza Thimali? Isn't this a contradiction? It's like a person who goes to the gym for 2 hours and does all kinds of exercises but comes back home and eats 3 burgers and a couple of cheesecakes and eats regular Pepsi, not diet Pepsi, but regular Pepsi. This is a contradiction. How is this possible? This is a form of hypocrisy. الغناء يمت النفاق في القلب. One day, Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam was asked about ghina. He was asked about singing and music. He told him, what is your opinion about singing and music? He told him, I'll have you answer. I'll let you answer. If al-haq, all of truthhood, was put on one side, and al-batil, falsehood, was put on another side, where do you think music would lie? Where do you think music and singing would lie, with al-haq or al-batil? The man said al-batil. He said, then there you go. You have the answer. We know it. It's in our instinctive nature. We know when a good deed is a good deed, and we know when a bad deed is a bad deed. Imam Ridha alayhi salam, he gives us the balance. He says, put good deeds on one side, al-haq on one side, and al-batil on another side, and you get to decide that this deed, where does it fall in? Under which category? One day, Imam al-Kadhim alayhi salam was passing by in the streets, was walking in the streets of Baghdad. He saw a house. The noise of music had filled the street. A house party, music, dancing. Imam al-Kalam saw that there's a slave, a female slave, standing at the door, maybe taking out the trash or whatever. She said, Imam al-Kadhim alayhi salam, he asked this female slave, he told her, this house, does it belong to a free man or a slave? Go ask the owner. Is he free or is he a slave? Because if he's free, if he's a slave, if he's genuinely a slave, he would not disobey his master. He would not disobey his master. This lady, she goes, the owner of the house, his name was Bish. She told him, "Ya Bish, there's a man who asks that, are you free, a free man or a slave? Because if you're a slave, you wouldn't disobey your master. If you were genuinely a slave, you would not disobey your master." Bish comes out barefoot. That is why historians call him Bishr al-Hafi, Bishr the barefoot. He came out walking barefoot. He came to Imam al-Kadhim alayhi salam. He realized that these are the words of the AhlulBayt. He came out and he sought forgiveness and repentance from this sin, the sin of holding house parties with loud music and with music. And this Bishr became a saint afterwards. He became a righteous person. صلى على محمد وعلى محمد. You see, my dear friends, there is a relationship between the heart and the ears. The heart is what controls the body. The heart and the mind, both. Sometimes when we say al-qalb, qalb al-mu'min, we mean both his mind and his heart. We don't just mean this organ that has veins that pumps up blood to the entire body. No. Al-qalb means both the mind and the heart. All of our senses, they have an effect on the heart. The eyes, the tongue. All of our senses, they have an effect on the heart. But the ears have the most amount of effect on the heart. إن السمع والبصر والفؤاد كل أولئك كان عنه مسؤولا. Allah first begins with the ears, that they will be asked regarding their hearing. إن السمع والبصر, and their sight. والفؤاد كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُمْ مَسْؤُولًا. They will be asked on the day of judgment on what they heard, on what they saw, on what they felt in their heart. Allah first begins with the hearing, because there's a direct relationship between what we hear and what sits in our heart. Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam in Rasalat al-Huquq, he says, in which he mentions the rights of people, the rights of your family members, the right of your teacher, the right of your slave, the right of your bodily organs. Even our bodily organs, they have rights. Our eyes have rights. Our tongue has rights. Our ears have rights. Imam Zain al-Abidin says, the right of your ears is to know that it is the direct pathway to your heart. Direct pathway to your heart. That means whatever goes into your ears immediately comes and sits in your heart. So what do you want to put in your heart? Good things or bad things? That means when you listen to music, it comes and sits in your heart. See, that's why the Imam says, إِنَّ الْغِنَاء يُنْبِتُ النِّفَاقَ where? إِنَّ الْغِنَاء يُنْبِتُ النِّفَاقَ فِي الْقَلْبِ. Singing puts hypocrisy in the heart. It instills, it segments hypocrisy in the heart. Hypocrisy will come and sit in your heart because there's a direct pathway from the ears to the heart. These ears of ours on the day of judgment, they will come and complain to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that my Lord, I was used in a way to disobey you. Our organs, their rights is that they should be used in a way for the obedience of Allah, not for the disobedience of Allah. Our bodily organs will come on the day of judgment. Our body parts will come on the day of judgment and complain. They will complain. They will say, oh Allah, our owner used us to disobey you. The Quran says, وَقَالُوا لِجُلُودِهِمْ لِمَ شَهَدْتُمْ عَلَيْنَا قَالُوا أَنْطَقَنَا اللَّهُ الَّذِي أَنْطَقَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. We will tell our bodily organs, our body parts on the day of judgment, be quiet, be quiet, don't expose us. We will tell our hands, our feet, our tongue, our ears that listen to music, shh, don't expose us. We will say, أَنْطَقَنَا اللَّهُ الَّذِي أَنْطَقَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. Allah give us the power to speak, so we will expose you. That's why we have to be careful. Our ears have rights. That right is not to be used in disobedience of Allah, rather to be used in His obedience. Music, my dear friends, it's one of the tools of shaitan. Yes. How do you think shaitan comes to us? Shaitan has many tools. Many tools. One of his tools is alcohol. إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسُرُ وَالْأَنصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ. One of his tools, one of his utensils to get to us, Bani Adam, to trick us, to deceive us, is through alcohol. Another utensil is gambling. Maysur. Maysur is gambling. This is one of his tools. One of his tools is singing and music. You tell me how, I'll tell you in the Quran. It says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenges shaitan. He says, yes, go. Go and fool Bani Adam. Go and trick Bani Adam. But let me tell you, you won't have an influence on all of them. Some of them will listen to you and some of them will not listen to you. The Quran says, وَاسْتَفْزِزْ مَنِ اسْتَطَعْتَ مِنْهُمْ بِصَوْتِكَ وَأَجْلِبْ عَلَيْهِمْ بِخَيْلِكَ وَرَكَبِكَ. Allah challenges shaitan. He says, yes, trick them and deceive them with your voice. With your voice. What is the voice of shaitan? What is the voice of shaitan? Is it not music? Is it not singing? That singing and music is one of the tools of shaitan. It's the sound of shaitan. It's the voice of shaitan that comes to us. But we don't know. We're enjoying ourselves. We raise the volume. We think this is nice. We think this is good. We're giving shaitan an entry to our body, to our system, to our mind, and to our hearts. وَاسْتَفْزِزْ مَنِ اسْتَطَعْتَ مِنْهُمْ بِصَوْتِكَ. My dear friends, صلى على محمد وعلى محمد. What is the problem with music? You might say, well, you've mentioned ahadith, you've mentioned verses and ahadith about music. But what's the problem? You didn't get to the core problem of music. You know what the problem with music is? The problem with music is that it's intoxicating. It's like a drug. Why are drugs haram? Why does Islam ban drugs? Because drugs, you think that it makes you feel good. Drugs, when a person takes drugs, he relaxes, he feels calm, he feels at ease, he forgets about life's problems and life's difficulties. But is this real? No. This feeling comfortable and feeling relaxed, how long does it last? As long as you're high. How long does the high last? An hour, 2 hours, 10 hours, I don't know. However long it lasts, you feel comfortable. As soon as the high leaves, it goes away, you come back to reality. This is exactly what music does, but on a lower level. Music also intoxicates, but on a lower level. When people listen to music, you think that they're paying attention to you. When a person is listening to music, you think that he's listening to you, paying attention to you, but he's not. His mind is completely somewhere else. When a person is listening to a love song, all of a sudden his mind goes somewhere else. He begins to fantasize about the person he loves. He imagines himself on an empty island next to a waterfall with the moonlight and beautiful stars. And immediately he's somewhere else. That lady is somewhere else. She begins to fantasize about the person that she loves. That's what music does. It takes you away. It takes your mind away. You begin to daydream. Why do people love music? Because they begin to daydream. It takes them somewhere else. They're awake, but at the same time, they're dreaming. They're somewhere else. Others, especially if they're listening to rap music, they imagine themselves driving a Lamborghini with dollars floating everywhere. And there's beautiful women sitting in the car, and he has guns, and there's a gang following. This is what music does. It takes you to a fantasy land. It takes you away from reality. That's why some people, when they're listening to music, if you dare turn off the radio, they'll kill you. Why do people get upset when you turn off the radio? Because you killed it for them. You killed it. They came back to reality. They're upset because they were somewhere, music had taken them into a special mind frame, to a special mentality. Now they're taken back. When you turn off the radio, they have to come back to boring reality, back to the boring life, back to reality of problems and troubles and exams and children and all of that. That's why I say music is intoxicating. Music takes over the mind and controls the mind, controls your thoughts. It gets you to fantasize and to daydream. Today I was reading research about music, and I saw that those who are pro music, they say, yes, music controls your mood, it relaxes you, it comforts you. But for how long? For how long? It's fake. If it genuinely comforted you and made you relax and took away boredom, it would remain forever. But it doesn't. It only remains for 5 minutes. How long is the song? 5 minutes? You feel comfortable for 5 minutes. As soon as the music is over, as soon as the song is over, you come back to your depression or to the state that you're in before. Whatever state that is. Some people think they can get away from depression by music. No. Because as soon as the music ends, they come back to depression. What is a real solution is what keeps depression away from you for good. It keeps you happy for good, not temporarily. And what is that? That is the remembrance of Allah. أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. With the remembrance of Allah, the effect is not temporary. When you read Qur'an, the effect of Qur'an doesn't remain for 5 minutes or 10 minutes. It remains how long? For a while. That tells you that the Qur'an is real and music is fake. The happiness that Qur'an gives you is real, and the happiness and the relaxation that music gives you is fake because it's temporary. Some say, but Sayyid, it feels good. I enjoy listening to music. It feels good. Doesn't this mean that it's natural? It feels good. My ears enjoy it. I say, yes. It's meant to feel good. But so does stealing a BMW from your neighbor. That also feels good. Eating in the month of Ramadan in the middle of the day, having lunch, that also feels good. Not everything that feels good is supposed to be halal and is supposed to be natural. That also, this is the test. The test is here, that it feels good. Physically, it feels good. But you stop yourself. You control yourself. You control your nafs. What is it? What good is it if you physically feel good, but then your nafs torments you? You feel guilty about it. What good is it if it feels good, but then the punishment remains? The punishment remains. Don't we have a hadith that says, كَمْ مِنْ لَذَّةٍ قَصِيرَةً أَعْقَبَتْهَا حَسْرَةً طَوِيلًا. There are some sins that are very temporary. The pleasure is very temporary. Very temporary. 5 minutes, 10 minutes of pleasure. But the punishment is forever. But the feeling of guilt is forever. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put in us a sense of guilt. Allah has given us a conscience and a sense of guilt. Those who listen to music usually feel guilty. They feel guilty. That sense of guilt is a sign. It's a sign that what you're doing is wrong. That what you're doing is a mistake. It's wrong. It's a sin. Is it worth it? Some people, they enjoy themselves for 5 minutes, but then for 5 hours they sit and they regret. They're remorseful. They feel guilty. Is it worth it? Of course not. My dear brothers and sisters, real comfort does not come from music. It's just like drugs. There's some people, you ask them, why do you take drugs? They say, I feel good. I forget my problems. Is this real? Is this a real answer? Is this real comfort? For you to spend so much money and risk your health to feel good for 5 minutes or 10 minutes or an hour, music is the same. It's not real comfort. And I wish that at least this music that our teens and our youth listen to was clean music. Listen to the words. It's full of profanity. It's full of bad words and profanity. These contemporary music, what is it about? It's about gangs. It's about drugs. It's about promiscuous acts. It's about violence, racism. All of the vices have gathered in music. That's why I tell some youth that the key to all the vices is music. If all the vices and all the sins have been locked in one room, the key to that room is music. Because when you listen to contemporary music, you're being exposed to profanity. You're being exposed to violence. You're being exposed to killing. Yes. Today, rap music, full of violence. It's full of violence. It promotes hatred and promotes racism and promotes killing. There's some music that even promotes suicide. Suicide, yes, it's in music. Promiscuous acts and promiscuous behaviors, isn't it? In music, especially music videos. Today it's not just music, but there's even music videos you get to watch. Isn't it full of promiscuous scenes? Scenes of half-naked or sometimes even fully naked women? See, it's not just about music, but about the things that are associated with music. Some say, Sayyid, I'm just listening to music. No, you're not just listening to music. You're polluting your mind. This gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you, this mind that's supposed to remain clean, music comes and destroys it. Music comes and puts all these disgusting ideas, sinful acts in your mind. And you begin to think of these ideas all day long. The more you listen to music, the more you think of these ideas. Some people even memorize the lyrics. Our youth, they memorize the lyrics and the songs. You ask them, how many chapters of the Qur'an have you memorized? They haven't memorized anything. But when it comes to songs and music, they'll say ila mashallah. They've listened, they've memorized so many lyrics and music and songs. Doesn't this affect them? Doesn't this affect their mind and affect their heart? This naturally takes you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you put these thoughts and minds, that music comes with it in your heart and mind, it takes you from Allah. It takes you away from Allah. How will you be able to come and stand in salah? I don't understand. Those who listen to music and then come and stand in front of Allah, that doesn't work. There's a contradiction. Music will even take you farther away. You won't even be interested in praying or reciting Qur'an or reciting munajat or reciting the supplications of Ramadan. If you see yourself staying away from Qur'an, ask why. Not only that, music also stirs desires. Even sexual desire is stirred in music. That's one of the things that it does. It triggers those emotions. Have you seen some nightclubs? What do they play in nightclubs? Why? What's the purpose of nightclubs? For young men and women to meet and then go on. What do they play? Do they play latmiyat and maulud? What is it that they play at nightclubs? They play music. Why? Because it puts you in the mood. It gets you to relax. It triggers certain emotions in you. It helps. It helps for those that have those sort of intentions. It helps them. Music puts you in the mood. Not just that, it desensitizes. Those that are against drugs, when they listen to music that is full of drugs, that talks about drugs, you become what? Drugs become something ordinary. Those that are against violence, but when you listen to music that is full of violence, it becomes ordinary. Or gangs, or guns, or whatever it is, even if it's something simple. To us, it's become simple. Before, it wasn't simple. Love, breakups, relationships, you become desensitized. When you listen to music all day that's full of lyrics that discuss these things, you become desensitized. Today, there's research going on in America. You know, in America, every couple of months, we hear of shootings, school shootings. A child goes to school, takes a gun, and shoots his classmates, his friends, his teachers. Some people in America, they started doing research. What is the cause? Some are coming up with a conclusion that one of the reasons behind this violence is what? You tell me, what is it? Music. Especially rap music that encourages violence. There's a relationship between violence and this sort of music because it desensitizes. Desensitizes. I saw some research that up to 80% of rap music mentions killing, violence, racism, alcohol, and drug use. 80% of rap music. So if you're a person that listens to rap music, you become desensitized. If you listen to country music, 37% of country music has the same sort of content. Drugs, promiscuity, violence, and so on and so forth. The music industry has become one of the largest industries in the world. Billions of dollars that they make annually. Our minds get polluted, but they become rich. These musicians, they pollute us. They pollute the minds of our youth and our children through their disgusting lyrics, but they become wealthy. They make money. They trick us with their music while they sit in large palaces and large mansions, and they become extremely wealthy. Not only is there music, but today there is music channels. There's channels on TV that are dedicated for music and music videos, like MTV and BET. Not only is it music, but they even try to portray, they make musicians as role models for the community. They portray their lives, their homes, their mansions. There's a TV show. There used to be. I don't know if still is. Not that I watch MTV. But there used to be a show called MTV Cribs. They show the homes of musicians, how they live, their pool, their cars, their jaguar, their whatever, as if portraying them as role models for our youth, role models for our children. Are these people worthy of being followed? Are they examples for our youth and our children? Unfortunately, many of them, many of these musicians themselves are the worst kind of people. They themselves, many of them, are drug addicts. Many of them have substance abuse. Many of them have committed suicide. I was looking up the names of musicians that have committed suicide. I found hundreds of names of musicians that committed suicide. And they say music brings comfort and relaxation. What sort of comfort is this? That the musician himself commits suicide. If music genuinely brought comfort, why didn't it bring comfort to the musician himself? Answer me this. I found tens of names, maybe hundreds of names of musicians that died from drug abuse. Drug abuse. Some of the famous names is Amy Winehouse, famous musician that died at the age of 48. Whitney Houston. No, I'm sorry. Amy Winehouse died at the age of 27. Whitney Houston, the famous singer, she died at the age of 48 from drug use. There was a famous rapper called Chris Cross. Some of the brothers are nodding. They've heard of the name. He died at the age of 34 from drug abuse. These are musicians. They're supposed to be happy. They say that music makes you happy. These guys, they died from drug abuse. They killed themselves. Michael Jackson died from drug abuse at the age of 50. What happiness is this that comes from music? What relaxation, what comfort is this? It didn't have an effect on the musicians. You expect that it has an effect on us? It brings happiness and comfort into our lives? Absolutely not. The problem, my dear friends, is that this is not just a problem in the English world or the American world or the Western world. Even in the Arabic world, even in the Islamic world, this is a problem. There's a TV show called Arab Idol. I don't know how many of you have heard of it. They encourage Muslim youth and Arab youth, to come and sing, to come become musicians. I see some, there are some youth from southern Iraq, they have beautiful voices. I say, subhanAllah, this person could have been a radood. This person could have came and served AhlulBayt, but instead he chose to serve whom? Serve Shaitan. I'll give you two examples. I don't wish to mention names. I think that the minbar is a lot more honorable than to mention names. But just to give an example for our youth to see. Two young men, both from Iraq, almost the same age. One chose, and they both have beautiful voices. They both have beautiful voices, and they're both Iraqi. One chose to use his voice to serve Shaitan. What's his name? Kadhim al-Sahir. Another Iraqi, well-known, almost the same age, who chose to use his voice for the service of Ahlul Bayt. What is his name? Basim al-Karbalai. From the same age, from the same country, but look, one who dedicated his life for Ahlul Bayt and the other dedicated his life for Shaitan because of this voice. This is not just a problem in the West. This is not just a problem in England or America. This is a problem in our homes as well. Abdul Halim Hafiz, the famous Egyptian singer, when he died, tens of people committed suicide. Tens of people committed suicide. That's how much they were intrigued by his music. That's how much his music had wit into their hearts. الغناء ينبت في القلب ينبت النفاق في القلب. It comes right into your heart. There's a problem, my dear friends. Some say, Sayyid, as I wrap up and conclude, because Maghrib is in about 4 or 5 minutes. Some say, we are addicted to music, Sayyid. How can we stop? You can stop, my dear friends. Yes, music is addictive. Especially if you listen to music all day long and all night in the car. I know some people, maybe they might not listen at work or at home, but in the car, as soon as they go in the car, they turn on the radio. They're addicted. Yes, it's hard to stop, but it's possible. It's possible, especially if you provide yourself with an alternative. If Find yourself an alternative, my dear friends. But a halal alternative. It has to be halal. Unfortunately, some of the mawali today, it's more like music to me. A lot of it is singing. It's about AhlulBayt, but it's singing. It's more like music. This is also haram. Just because it has AhlulBayt or the name of Imam Ali or Imam Hussein, this doesn't make it halal. Don't think that this has become halal. No. Find yourself an alternative. You can. Let's try to develop a culture against music, my dear friends. Let's kick music away from our lives. Because when you kick music away from your life, you're kicking a lot of vices away from your life. You're keeping shaitan away from your life. When you tell your children not to listen to music, at the same time, you're protecting them against violence and drugs and promiscuity and racism. Don't think it's just music, it's just a pretty voice and nice beats. No, it's a lot bigger than that. Some think that music is haram, but except at weddings. At weddings, there is an exception. No, my dear friends. Music is haram everywhere. Whether it's at weddings or at a fatiha, doesn't make a difference. Whether you're sitting at a funeral or at a wedding, music is haram. Let's say no, my dear friends. Let's take the time, especially during the month of Ramadan, when our nafs is becoming stronger. You see, in Ramadan, you're abstaining from eating and drinking, the things that you need the most. Your nafs is becoming stronger. You're disciplining yourself. Thus, make use of this time to stop listening to music as well. If you can say no to eating and drinking, then you could easily say no to music as well. Thus, I invite youth that have difficulty with music, take the month of Ramadan. Take advantage of the month of Ramadan to say no to music and cut it from your life. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Raise your hands in dua, brothers and sisters. اللهم إني أسألك أن تجعل فيما تقضي وتقدر من الأمر المحتوم في الأمر الحكيم من القضاء الذي لا يرد ولا يبدل أن تكتبنا من حجاج بيتك الحرام المبرور حجهم المشكور سعيهم المغفور ذنوبهم المكفر عنهم سيئاتهم وأن تجعل فيما تقضي وتقدر أن تطيل عمري في خير وعافية وتوسع في رزقي وتجعلني ممن تنتصر به لدينك ولا تستبدل بي غيري أعوذ بجلال وجهك الكريم أن ينقضي عني شهر رمضان أو يطلع الفجر من ليلتي هذه ولك قبلي تبعة أو ذنب تعذبني عليه ولأرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات والعلماء والشهداء نقرأ سورة الفاتحة مع الصلوات